Welcome to the School Sucks Project, a podcast, YouTube channel, and online community dedicated to personal growth and intellectual self-defense.
We promote learning alternatives, home education, critical thinking, peaceful parenting, organization and productivity, and better communication strategies.
Please remember to visit schoolsucksproject.com to get comprehensive show notes, relevant links,
or to just leave comments.
Follow us on Twitter at School Sucks Show. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, username School Sucks Podcast, and get involved in our Facebook group. Just search for School Sucks Project.
Steve, welcome back to School Sucks.
Great to be with you again. I've been looking forward to this conversation all week.
Indeed, this is a big one. And I have a question that I want to ask. We're on to now the third principle of learning anything, which you describe as mastering the basics or the fundamentals, correct? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And just before I start the slow process of leading up to my question, what is the essence of mastering the basics in the context of these five principles?
So the basics are what coaches sometimes call the fundamentals. They are the bread and butter core techniques that you're going to be using 80 to 90% of the time, regardless of what you're doing.
Now, I would think that in the layout of the five principles, this would be the place to start. But it comes right in the middle. And the reason why, you know, I feel that way might be based on my experience with a lot of the better learning and better doing projects we've done at School Sucks over the last couple years. And a pattern that has emerged in trying to learn a new discipline, a new methodology, a new process. And I would basically just describe it in my own terms as step one being acknowledgement and identification. The question of what exists and what is it? And then step two would be a kind of acceptance and integration. So this is crossing several different types of pursuits, intellectual, emotional, organizational, even communication. So step two, acknowledgement and integration would basically be how do these things work together? Where do contradictions exist? In what I've gathered in step one. And step three would be a kind of action or intention, taking what has been gathered and integrated in the first two steps and ultimately making it useful or being able to communicate it to others. So useful to myself or useful to other people. Mm-hmm. And since 2013, we've seen this pattern turn up in several places. I did a series on the learning method known as the trivium, which originated in ancient Greece. And the language that trivium scholars use is grammar, logic, and rhetoric. So the grammar is the gathering up of the small pieces, what I would think would be most in line with mastery of the basics. And if you're trying to learn, like, let's say a historical subject, the grammar would be the what, the who, the when, and the where. So it's a lot of definition, essentially, even though definition is also a part of logic. When you move on to the second step, logic, it is, again, finding out where the contradictions exist, trying to remove them, basically having a filter, and a kind of integration. How do these pieces of raw data that I've gathered about this subject work together? The rhetoric is the communication or the making useful of that. Now, we did, I don't know, 6 or 7 hours of shows on this methodology called the trivium, but that's a very brief synopsis. And I saw it appear in other places as well. A friend of mine and a colleague named Richard Grove was really, really helpful with this. He was actually the one who I think first noticed the pattern. We talk about organization and productivity on the show. And I was mentioning to you the methods of David Allen, what he calls getting things done. He uses a 5-step process, but it's essentially the same thing. So his whole, like, how do you get organized and get things done? Well, you collect everything that's going on around you. You know, some people just have junk everywhere and they don't have any way to make sense of it. So you collect it, you organize, or you process it, which is basically identification. You organize it, which is basically that same process of kind of integration and getting rid of things that don't need to be there. you review it to make sure that the first three steps have been done correctly, and then you do it, you execute it. But it's basically that same input process output method that the trivium follows. So we also talked about this in communication. We also talked about this in Nathaniel Brandon's Six Pillars of Self-Esteem, the six practices that you do for more positive self-regard in life also seem to follow that same model. So we see it in a lot of places. I just really wanted to get your thoughts on what I've described so far, because that's basically the pattern that we've worked with for almost 3 years now. And maybe also a discussion of how what you're presenting here might line up with that, or where it doesn't.
Sure. I think my set of five principles are specifically geared towards learning and understanding. So execution is obviously relevant if you want to do something, but there's one step prior to execution, which is understanding, and it is competence. So if you're not competent in most circumstances, you're not going to execute well. Self-esteem, for example, is not really something that these principles cover. This is just about those abstract principles that you'll discover specifically when you're trying to learn or understand something, even if it's mental, if it's a concept or a topic that you're trying to learn in economics, for example. If it's physical, it's a discipline, you're trying to learn how to play a better tennis game, or if it's practical, if it's you're trying to learn how to weld, all of these things, regardless of what you're trying to learn, you get these same abstract principles at play. So there's certainly some overlap, I think, with the three-step process. This is kind of a little bit more geared towards specifically the process of learning, at least as I have discovered them. I'm sure there are lots of other principles that are out there and different kind of mindsets that you can approach these topics, but these are the main ones that I've discovered.
Sure. So why do we put an understanding of, or really a mastery of, the basics in the middle of these five principles?
So what I would say is you have to go through, if there's any linearity to these principles, it's the first one is the principle of technique. That is the most abstract of all of them. So the basics is a derivative of the principle of technique. Technique, the basics are one step lower than technique. The reason I put efficiency before the basics is because efficiency is kind of what good technique looks like. It is one of the features that if you're trying to examine, well, obviously, in theory, we'd like to have good technique. What does it even look like? How do we identify and say, well, what technique should I try to have? It's that technique which has efficiency to it, has fluidity to it. And so this, the basics, is kind of one step more concrete in the sense of once you identify the technique, you identify the efficient technique, this is now kind of the first practical approach for how you go about learning those basic principles, those basic techniques, which will be efficient as a function of having objectively correct technique, if that makes sense.
Sure. Well, another way to say it perhaps would be envisioning the end, that even though you're going to start with an understanding of what the basics are and how to execute each one of them, whether it's as an action or something as small as a definition, you're doing it with the consideration of how they're going to be integrated later, right?
Exactly.
Into an overall technique with a focus on a kind of efficiency in execution.
Right. And you might even say, you can illustrate with a question. You could say, the basics of what?
Mm-hmm.
So that implying, it's not just the basics for the sake of the basics. It's you have to have that end goal, that end technique in mind that you're trying to learn in order to then sensibly say, oh, now these are the basics that I'm going to focus on learning.
Right. Now, in the conversations that we've had, not recorded so far, talking about this, the basics, whether we're talking about, you know, the world of music, or we've used Roger Federer as an example several times, the basics are really, I don't know if it's fair to say everything, but there isn't like some other realm of non-basic function technique,
yes,
right? Everything is really, really about the basics, even when you watch somebody who's extraordinarily talented at what they do.
Yes, this is incredibly important and profound to understand, which is why I say that the basics are 80 to 90% of everything that you're doing. There's a wonderful quote in the dojo that I train Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in on the wall, and it's from the head instructor, and he has this brilliant quote that is applicable not just to the martial arts but to everything. He says, the basics work against an unskilled opponent, and they are the only thing that works against a skilled opponent. Meaning, if somebody really knows what they're doing, then flashy punches and kicks and rolling on the ground and doing cartwheels and backflips and all these, the fanciness is not what actually works if somebody knows what they're doing. If somebody can effectively, knows basic ideas of how to defend themselves, you have to have a mastery or more superior mastery of the basics than they do if you want to defeat them. And this is the case in every discipline imaginable. It is true in tennis. You watch Roger Federer, like I've said many times, he's not doing backflips on the court. He's just executing the basic shots, at an extremely high degree. This is true in the world of ideas. It's true in something like economics. Understanding economics is almost synonymous with understanding the basics of economics. You have to know the basic concepts. And once you know the basic concepts, you understand economics. It doesn't mean that you're necessarily an economist, but it means that you grasp the topic. And what you discover, what I've discovered many times in just growing up around people, is a lot of people focus on the 10% and not the 90%. They don't focus on the basics. They focus on the flashy 10%. So in something like music, for example, this is a great example is in like piano. I had some friends growing up. We all were learning how to play the piano. I had some friends that could play some parts of some songs very quickly, right? They would take the Mozart piece, and they would kind of butcher the first part and kind of butcher the second part. There's this really fancy trill in the middle that, oh, wow, look, his right hand's moving really quickly. And that's all that they would practice. And that was the entirety of their ability to play the piano. And you might say, yes, okay, in one area they could execute well, but would you say they understood how to play the piano? Would you say they've mastered or they have competence in the piano? No, they don't. They didn't understand scales. They didn't understand how to play slowly in time and understand how to play the right notes. It was just this little 10%. Or like on the tennis court, I was playing tennis years ago with a guy who he focused almost all of his efforts on his serve. Okay, yeah, he had a good serve, but he had a terrible backhand. Like, if you could get the serve back and you hit it to his backhand, he couldn't hit a backhand. Well, if you can't hit a backhand, you don't understand tennis. You're not a good tennis player if you don't have one of these foundational shots, which is the backhand. That principle you see over and over.
Yeah, and it translates to my experience playing the guitar, right? And we talked about that earlier. When I stumble upon a site called Tabs 41, I'm picturing like Tabs 911 as the name of the site, but that can't be right. That's a terrible name for that. I think maybe Tabs 411. Okay. And I say, here's the Rosetta Stone of playing the guitar.
Naturally.
Very, very disastrous results. And all these examples, the metaphor that I'm picturing, what you're describing, is like that scene in Raiders of the Lost Ark where some kind of master swordsman appears in a crowd and does all his best moves 20 feet away from a guy with a gun,
right?
You know, and says, oh, I have a solution for this. So, yeah, the fancy pants stuff isn't ultimately going to lead to success or the desired outcome.
Yes, and there's something even more profound at play here, that when you master the basics, then you can do the advanced techniques. The competent execution of advanced techniques or advanced concepts only come from a mastery of the basics. It's not the other way around. You see this in mathematics, you see this in economics, you see this in practical disciplines. You don't somehow gain a good execution of the basics just by knowing some advanced techniques. You don't do that. That's not the way it works. However, if you do master the basics, you will be able to execute by extension more advanced techniques. That happens all the time. It's like something, for example, in economics. If you understand the core ideas of comparative advantage, and you understand the effects of tariffs and subsidies, right? You get those things and you understand prices and profits and losses, right? You have a good basic understanding of economics. Then when you're talking about some complex dynamic between trade relations between five different countries and the effect of, these trade agreements between all these countries, it's very complex, lots of moving parts. Well, you can understand them clearly because you understand the basics.
Right.
If from the beginning you're trying to focus on these complex things and you don't even understand the basics, there's not a chance that you're going to know what you're talking about.
Indeed. Let's actually step away from that and return to tennis.
Yeah.
You're a tennis player?
Yes.
Okay. Now, we've talked several times about admiration for Federer, and in the assembly of the shows that we've done so far, I've watched lots of Roger Federer clips to try and find some to incorporate in the show. Now, I see, like, most of the things are like Roger Federer top 10 shots, that kind of thing, Roger Federer highlights, and I watch him. I played a little tennis. I've watched a little tennis. This is clearly the most amazing example of a tennis player that I've ever seen.
Yes.
But I know that I'm supposed to be impressed by what I'm seeing, and I am.
Yes.
But how would you describe to a novice like me, when it comes to tennis, what are the basics in that sport? You know,
yes.
the really, really primary things. How does Roger Federer, I know this is a little bit of a tricky question without video, but that is something that could be fixed in post-production. What are the places where Roger Federer really, really excels? And more generally, what are the basics in a sport like tennis?
Yes, no problem. So I'd say off the top of my head, you have kind of two categories of the basics. You have your basic shots, and then you have everything else. So you have the basic shots in tennis are your forehand, your backhand, your overhead smash, your volley shot, which is kind of instead of hitting to the back of the court, you do a nice delicate shot in the front, and then your serve. Those are your basic shots. If you have those shots, you have 90% of the shots in tennis. There are more advanced shots. Yes, there's what's called the hot dog, which is having the racket and hitting it between your legs, and there's diving shots. Yes, but those very rarely come up. The basics are those five main shots. Now, in the category of everything else, you have things like footwork, absolutely essential to all the shots is having the correct footwork to the shots, and timing, when you're hitting the ball in terms of it's the path that the ball takes when you're making contact with the ball, and something like your angles, where you're hitting the ball on the court. I'd say that pretty much describes 90% of the tennis game. And what Roger Federer does is master virtually every aspect of that. His footwork is gorgeous. His forehand has been described accurately so as a great liquid whip. It's very efficient. It's very relaxed. An extreme amount of power. And the placement of his shots are extraordinary, are absolutely nothing other than extraordinary. So if you don't, like if somebody doesn't understand the game of tennis, of course they're going to look at it and say, well, I don't understand what's so impressive. But the degree to which he gets all of those things right is the degree to which he has been the most dominant tennis player of all time.
Right. So I think I saw in one of the clips a shot where he's facing away from the net and he hits a shot between his legs.
Yes. That's the hot dog.
Not facing the other guy.
Right.
But so when you say Roger Federer's not doing backflips, that might be the closest example on the surface to the back completely unnecessary, seemingly unnecessary backflip shot. But I would even say that to be able to execute the hot dog, there are basics that come into that too. Now, I'm just adding my own names to them, like control of the racket, spatial awareness is probably a really important one.
Sure.
A keen understanding of distances.
Exactly. How do you hold the racket? I mean, that's an excellent example of the basics. In fact, we'll talk about that. I want to talk a little bit later about drawings, but that's an excellent example of something that we wouldn't even think about, right? Like, how are you literally holding the tennis racket? Because if you get that part wrong and you're not holding the tennis racket the right way, every shot you make is going to have this kind of methodological problem to it.
Well, there's no place, I think, where that's clearer than in golf. The way that you hold the club I don't want to say it's everything, but as somebody who struggled with golf, I got pretty good. I got down to a little less than a 10 handicap at my best, and that was playing every day, taking lessons. But it ain't like riding a bike. I'll tell you what, if you don't play for a while, it goes away. And, you know, through everything I tried, there's so many elements in a golf swing, and there's different types of golf swings, obviously, depending on your distance from the pin. You can execute perfectly through the backswing, the angle of your backswing and the speed of your backswing, the way you come down, the way your hips pivot, all of that. But if you're not holding the club correctly, it doesn't matter, you know?
That's correct.
And it was actually, who's that motivational speaker, self-help guy? Tim, I want to say Tim Robbins, but that's not it. I'm not sure. Big tall guy, Anthony Robbins. You know, he talks about the difference of millimeters, that he sucked at golf because his, it was off by a millimeter or two, but,
yes,
you know, down the fairway, it translates to 100 yards sometimes,
right,
and different. So yeah, I'd say that was really where I started to focus on how much the little things related to technique matter was playing golf.
And how profound is this principle? Because that precise phenomena you see everywhere. You see it so pronounced in the world of ideas, in philosophy. If you get your methodology for thinking wrong, if you get your epistemology wrong, you make one of these little foundational errors very far down in your worldview, then you're going to make errors throughout your worldview. It's these little millimeter wrong in the basis of your worldview will result in radically inaccurate conclusions. And I want to say too, wouldn't it be funny to think if somebody spent their time trying to learn and be good at tennis, if they spent all of their time trying to master the hot dog, right? And somebody is like, yeah, and say they get really good at it. They're like the best hot dog shot on the planet. How often does it come up? Like, are they going to run around the court putting their body in a very silly fashion so that they can turn backwards and hit the ball between their legs because that's all they're good at? We would laugh at them. We'd say, well, that's, yeah, okay, you have one good shot, but you're totally missing all of tennis, which is 99% not that. It's the same case in music. Somebody plays these fancy little trills all day. It's like, yeah, okay, that's all you can do, but you still don't understand what you're talking about or what you're doing.
I think golf is, golf is good for, you know, the young person and like learning refinement, because there is no hot dog equivalent in golf. You know, if you try to do the Happy Gilmore shot, they're just going to come out and ask you to leave. Right. There's nothing like that in golf that you can do. And right, that's rare for a sport, because every sport has its like ESPN, you know, Sports Center top 10 highlight.
Yeah. Yeah, interesting.
Right. But golf doesn't have that.
That's very interesting.
I mean, I guess how far you can hit the ball, like Tiger Woods popularized that, you know, 15 years ago. And, he made us try to hit the ball farther, but there is no hot dog in golf. So it really is focusing on, you want to get good results. You don't want, there's nothing showy or flashy to take the place of good results. The only point at the end of, you know, the golf game, besides to get some fresh air, to walk and to spend time with friends, is did you win or not? What was your score?
Exactly.
Right? So flashy moves don't count in that sport. It's good for learning in that way.
Yes, that's a great example. And there's another very profound principle at play in all these. And it's something like this, that you have to know the basics in order to know when to break them. So Roger Federer can get away with the crazy hot dog shot because he has everything else in place. And in fact, there's highlight reels of that particular shot because it happens so infrequently. But when he does it, he has pretty good success on that. I doubt it's because he's practiced it very much. It's just because he has all the other things in order. You see this perhaps most pronounced in chess. There are basic principles, there are basic core ideas in chess which are foundational about, for example, the traditional way of thinking about pawn structure is that you want to have your pawns in a dominant position in the middle of the board, for example. Well, there's plenty of ways that you can play and totally disregard that principle, but only if you know what you're doing. If you don't know what you're doing, and you're disregarding the basics, you're going to get smashed. Happens all the time.
And one of the things that we talked about too was that whenever we move on to these more advanced and complex types of movements, and you mentioned that they're rare when in the case of Federer or what we see on SportsCenter, they're usually incorrect.
Right.
Now,
or unnecessary. Yeah.
Unnecessary and incorrect, or. Yeah, because I don't know if there's. I'm just wondering: is there even a correct way to do some of these moves? Okay,
there is in an extreme circumstance. So let's say, for example, the reason that Federer's between the legs shot was because he found himself in a position where his back was to the net. Let's say, you know, he was moving to the right of the court. He turned his back and all of his weight is on his left foot. So there's not an easy way for him to comfortably turn around. There's not a good way for him, for his racket to hit the shot. It's conceivable that in some circumstance, if all of your weight is distributed in a particular way, that the only way you can hit that shot is by swinging the racket between your legs. That's totally possible. It just doesn't come up very much.
So just a takeaway from what we've discussed so far is that when you do have to do something that is a significant and noticeable deviation, I guess, from basic technique, you really only want to try to execute if you already are very well versed, if not a master of the most essential fundamental aspects of what you're doing.
Yes. Now let's take a conceptual example.
All right.
Take something like negative interest rates in economics. Something which is very relevant to today's world. We have many countries around the globe that have negative interest rates. Now, the idea, the understanding the concepts involved is, okay, what is an interest rate and how in the world can it be negative? You would have to come up with the most extreme and crazy circumstance to think there could be some legitimate reason to have negative interest rates. I suppose if like there's a massive fire that's going on and the only safe place to put your money is in the bank and like they're going to charge you for it and it's like they charge you to save, but it's okay because otherwise you'd lose more. Yeah, in this crazy circumstance, you could have short-term negative interest rates. But that's not what's going on at all in the modern world. We have people who don't understand the basics in charge of central banks around the globe that have lowered interest rates to negative rates, and it's causing all kinds of catastrophic misallocation of resources. That's a prime example of these people who don't really understand the basics of what they're talking about, doing this really extreme thing and it resulting in a terrible circumstance.
Okay, so this is the golf ball 50 yards off the fairway in the woods.
Yeah.
What was the tiny little bit, or maybe not so tiny little bit, they were off, you know, when they first addressed the ball on the tee? Like, how do we get negative interest rates? And first of all, just for the people who aren't so well versed in economics, maybe you could describe this phenomenon a little bit and maybe a little bit about the economic ideology that created this situation too. I'd be interested to hear that.
Sure. So you have to start with the basics of what is an interest rate. Interest rate is one way of thinking of the interest rate is simply the price of money. It's the price of borrowing money. So if you go to the bank and you're trying to get a loan for a car for $10,000 and they charge you a 10% interest rate, then if you need a loan for $10,000, they're going to say, okay, when you pay this back, it has to be 10% interest. So essentially you're paying money, you're paying for the privilege of having money in the short term.
Yeah, the price of the timeliness of money. Okay, sure.
Exactly. So what happens is there's this incredible dynamic when you have a free market of when more and more people in the economy save their money in banks, it increases the reserve of potential money to lend out to entrepreneurs. So you have a centralization of money in banks, and then that naturally lowers the rate of interest, which allows easier loans to go out to entrepreneurs who need money for whatever reasons. Contrary, in times where people are saving their money, they're not putting their money in the bank, for example, interest rates will go up because it'll entice people to put money into the bank so that the bank can then turn around and lend out that money to entrepreneurs who need loans. So when you have a lot of people that are putting their money into the bank, it allows the bank to lend out money at a cheaper rate, and you have this wonderful equilibrium effect. Okay. That's in a free market. Now, what happens is when you have the centralization of the banking system, you have the interest rate that is now set by decree. It's not set by this relationship between savers and consumers. It's set by decree, meaning the interest rate is going to be whatever we say it is.
Right.
And the idea is, I won't go into all of this confused monetary theory, but the idea is in times of recession, the central bank should lower the interest rate to stimulate the economy so people can get more loans, which is supposed to bring us out of the economy, and then the central bank is supposed to raise interest rates again. Never works, it never has worked, and yet people hang on to this theory. But that's another story. So what you have is, pretty much the first time in history, the international financial situation has been so bad that central bankers around the globe have said, well, we can't lower interest rates any farther, nominally speaking. We've already hit 0% interest rates, meaning that essentially the price of borrowing money for banks is non-existent. They can trade amongst themselves and they can borrow money from the central bank at no cost. This is like historically unprecedented because the economy has been so bad. And we've now dipped into this very weird world just in the last few years of negative interest rates. What a negative interest rate means is that if you want to deposit your money at the bank, they're going to charge you for it. They no longer pay you to deposit money at the bank. They charge you for it. Now, you would think intuitively that this would mean that, you know, hell has frozen over and this makes no sense. But it makes sense in one circumstance. If the financial state of an economy is so bad that people are worried about the health, like whether or not their money is going to essentially disappear. If they put it in stock markets, it might go down to zero or whatever. They'll put it into a bank for safety. They're paying for the safety of having their money at the bank. Now, you can imagine the kind of distortions that are going to result in the economy because of that perversion. Now you have entrepreneurs that are able to get these loans they would otherwise never be able to get because interest rates are so low. This is something that Ludwig von Mises, the economist, talked about. You have what he called malinvestment. When you have an artificial lowering of the interest rate, you have malinvestment, meaning people getting loans they shouldn't otherwise be able to get. And that is only compounded manyfold when you have negative interest rates. So if we were to actually have a free market economy, it would be a very open question whether or not you could ever reach the point of having negative interest rates. I would say, practically speaking, probably not, because you wouldn't have these crazy, insane boom and bust cycles, but it's at least a conceptual possibility. But unfortunately, the system that we have now is we have negative interest rates, this monstrously extreme monetary policy that is now declared by a group of central planners.
Yeah, and people can see this when you talk about malinvestment. We've covered this on the show a little bit before. You have the dot-com boom in the 90s, the housing bubble that blew up in, 2008. The one I think that most people in my audience are familiar with, probably from experience and from the amount of discussion on this show, is the current bubble. It's more like a hot air balloon, the student loans. And that's going to come to an end soon and probably be a pretty significant economic tragedy.
Yes.
So, thanks. I appreciate the illustration. I know you touched on this a little bit, but I'm going to ask just for a little bit of expansion. In economic theory, this idea that, a group of wise elder types should be able to dictate interest rates.
Yes.
What is its origin?
That's a great question. Here's my honest answer. I think the ultimate origin is in human arrogance.
Okay.
I think you see a consistent theme throughout history, ancient and present, that people desperately want to view themselves as being really intelligent, more intelligent than their neighbors, and so much so that they can plan out society in some superior way than the brutes that make up society. Now, it's very difficult. It's a very tempting idea because, quite frankly, the general public is not very educated on a lot of things. But Friedrich Hayek called it the fatal conceit to make the leap from I think I understand what might be better for people in terms of economic progress and so on, and to make that leap from therefore I'm going to plan it out for them using the tools of the government. And ultimately, I think that all central planning ultimately comes down to hubris. People think they know more than they actually do. And that's okay as long as it's not coupled with the powers of government. When you have ignorant people, self-righteous people who think they can plan out society, that's great if they're isolated. But when they all get together and then they get the tools of the state and then they have this violent apparatus of enforcing their ideas, whether you like it or not, then that's a very dangerous principle, as evidenced by all of history and especially the 20th century.
Yeah, I think when power is attached to this phenomenon that you're describing, it's very easy to ascribe conspiracy to it as well. You know, one of the things that I realized researching the history of schooling in this country is a lot of it was fear. You know, certainly hubris is a part of it. I mean, that's one of the ideas that I think is reinforced in the halls of academia, for sure. But it's also a kind of fear of the masses. These people are insane and they will kill us and they're almost everybody and we're almost nobody. You know, I recently heard, I learned about this a long time ago, obviously, but I was recently reminded about the concept of superdelegates.
Yeah, right.
Right? How this turned up in New Hampshire. And right. I was talking to my father about it a few days ago, and he said, you know, the Republicans don't have this. Only the Democrats have this. And I said to him kind of jokingly, it's like, well, yeah, but they're the caretakers of the stupid. They, you know, they can't let people make their own decisions. They're here to help people, right. And protect them from themselves. You know, make sure they don't get their hands on anything that explodes or that is too sharp or right. knowing when they should have a helmet on and knowing how much money they should give to the government. Right. So that there's a lack of faith in humanity that I think is exacerbated by hubris. But for me, from my research and the areas that I've researched it, it really, in the early 20th century, stemmed from a kind of widespread fear, or widespread in the intellectual and academic community.
That's a very interesting, I've never heard that theory. That's very interesting. Do you think that's also the case? Like, I could understand that more in Europe, for example, based on the history of aristocracy, that, you know, you would have the serfs and the peasants versus the royalty. Do you think that same phenomena was at play even in something like the progressive United States in the turn of the century?
Oh, absolutely. And mostly really? Because of European immigration, I would say. And, you know, I did a lot of work a little over a year ago with a historian, and actually he's a professor at Occidental, Obama's alma mater. His name's Thaddeus Russell, and he wrote a book called The Renegade mm-hmm. History of the United States. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he talks about this influx of immigrants and just how petrifying it was for the upper class, the intellectual class, to see these people in the streets of the cities that had once only had, you know, a very homogeneous type of demographic. And, you know, that was really the impetus behind the setting up of the school system, going back to the days of Horace Mann. So we're even, you know, 40 years before the progressive era really begins. The end of slavery and the first wave of immigration, I think, said to a lot of the management class, the scientific management class, we need to get organized here. You know, all these people who used to be basically harnessed by the plantation system, and all these people who want to bring their, you know, non-Puritan, libertine cultural practices, especially lower income immigrants like the Irish and the Italians and freed black people, that really didn't jive with their, you know, Puritan or Protestant work ethic, ivory tower, worldview. Mm. So I think that was a huge part of it over a period of about, I mean, if you want to go from Horace Mann up through, basically the full establishment of the public schooling system, that covers like 70 years, both waves of European immigration. Yeah, absolutely.
So if we could, there's one more idea specifically related to the basics that I think would be really helpful for your listeners.
Sure.
And it has to do with practice. So if anybody's interested in this topic, I recommend the book. It's called The Art of Learning by Josh Whiteskin, who's also really interested in the art of learning. He's learned a lot of different things, chess and the martial arts, interestingly enough. It's one of the reasons I like him. And he accurately identifies this beautiful phenomenon that you see, not just in learning something and learning the basics, but actual mastery. So there's a difference between the two. I think learning is ultimately the goal, but if you want to take some topic that you're really passionate about or some discipline and go transition from learning to mastery, there is a concrete way of doing it. And it has to do with practicing those basic movements, those basic techniques, or the basic concepts slowly. And the idea is to build literal neurological muscle memory, where you are training your brain to be able to move in these basic ways where you don't have to think about it anymore. Like when you're trying to learn for example, in jiu-jitsu, when you're trying to learn the basic motion of what's called a hip escape, it's this essential technique you have to know. It's both for attack and defense. It's absolutely critical. When you first learn how to do it and you try to break it down piece by piece, it's very clunky. It's very hard and like, it feels awkward and your body's never moved that way. But if you get that technique right and you practice it over and over correctly and slowly, eventually it becomes muscle memory. You don't even have to think about it. You literally don't have to think about it. Your body just does it. And at that point, if you can get to that point of like neurological, burning it into your brain, then you're getting one step down the path of actual mastery. Because then, like this phenomena of effortlessness, like we were talking about last time, that's actually what you see in the shots of Roger Federer. He's not thinking, okay, I have to go through and do all these things in my perfect technique and I got to turn my hips this way. It's not conscious. He's done it so many times that it actually is almost effortless. He's just got to get his body positioned correctly and let it fly. And then you get these incredibly buttery, smooth, beautiful technical shots. So that is also true, for example, in the world of ideas, right? With economics, you have to ground yourself in the concepts of trade. What is the phenomena of trade? What is happening? If you grasp this idea of mutually beneficial exchange, for example, one of these foundational concepts, you don't have to think about it. It just becomes becomes, I guess you could call intuitive, but it's second nature. It's like, well, of course, like if you can't understand the nature of economics, if the understanding mutually beneficial trade is not something that is just, it becomes obvious because it's burned in your brain deliberately.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And in the martial arts, what was the quote that one of your jiu-jitsu instructors said to you or used repeatedly?
There's two quotes. One was on the wall about the basics, and the other was Omar when he was talking about theory versus practice. Which one are you?
I think when I first read it, it sounded like something that Mr. Miyagi would say, and you're like, yeah, whatever. Okay, I guess that's not for us to understand, right? It's too cryptic. But after your explanation, one of the things that you wrote down was slow is smooth.
Smooth is
fast.
Oh, I see what you're saying. This is another instructor.
Yeah. Yes.
So this is a, yes. This is a, that does sound like Mr. Miyagi now that you mentioned
but
it.
But after your explanation, it makes perfect sense.
Yes. So let me explain that. So this is my instructor in Japanese jiu-jitsu. He had this phrase. He would say, slow is smooth and smooth is fast. Now we could take the mystical approach and say, oh, wow, isn't that, you know, nonsensical and deep? Or we could actually break that down. And what he was saying is, You refine your techniques by doing them slow. There's no rush. The goal is not to execute. The goal is not to execute. The goal is to do it slow, understand why and how you're doing what you're doing. You do it over and over and over, slowly, so that it becomes smooth. So then it's fluid and you don't have to think about it. It's like, yeah, okay, I've done that 10,000 times, that basic motion. And then before you know it, that smoothness turns into quick execution because you don't have to think about it anymore. It's the same thing you see with like playing the piano, for example. You don't, if you're trying to learn a really fast part on the piano, you don't just practice really fast. This is how a lot of people do it and they get nowhere. You can't do it that way. If you want to actually be able to execute quickly and competently, you have to practice painfully slow. I mean like a quarter the speed you'd like to play. And then once it's perfect, you've got to execute it perfectly without an error. You crank it up just a little bit. And it's like, gosh, I've done this 10,000 times. It's so dang boring. And as you start cranking it up, before you know it, you're going to be doing exactly, you want to be executing at the speed you want to, perfectly, precisely. And then what some people will do, like professional pianists, for example, they'll practice their songs at like double speed, maybe not literally double speed, but more quickly than the song actually requires. So people that are playing these outrageously fast things like Liszt on the piano, which have these, you can't even see these pianist fingers because they're moving so quickly, that's slow to them. Mm-hmm. So not only have they've mastered to such a degree where they can play, you know, 1.5 times as fast, and then it's like they're literally playing slowly in order to execute at this blistering fast pace. That's the secret. That's what's going on. That's how these people can execute to such high degrees.
Interesting. Now we have two more very distinct kind of areas that I want to cover with regard to mastery of the basics. The first I want to talk about is philosophy. And then we said we'd talk a little bit about podcasting. So we have what you do and what I do. And, you know, in philosophy, I was wondering, is there, because there's so much diversity and, you know, some people who are philosophers would look at other people who say, I'm a philosopher and say, that's not philosophy, you know, what you're doing. So is there one branch of philosophy? Like, and really, I think we'll just focus on the first four, metaphysics, epistemology, ethics, and politics, mm-hmm. where more costly errors or misunderstandings or complete disregards for the fundamentals takes place? Is there one branch that's really prone to those kinds of errors?
Without a doubt, it is epistemology. Epistemology is the study of knowledge. It is the study of the methodology of thinking. Are there ways that we can go about thinking which result in knowledge? And are there ways which we go about thinking which result in inaccurate knowledge or fallacies? And you, if you're trying to understand philosophy, you cannot actually understand philosophy without diving into epistemology. Now, that epistemology is the bedrock. That is the foundation for not just for philosophy, but ultimately for all critical thinking, because all thinking about anything presupposes these epistemological concepts. But that is the bottom. This is not something that you intuitively wake up and realize. This is something that as you start learning about philosophy, it sucks you in because it's like, oh, this is way more important. Can't be dealing with these ethereal concepts that are way out there in ethics if I don't even understand the process of knowing things. That is foundational. That's the bedrock. But there is one other area which is not as bedrock, but it's equally incredibly important. And if you get it wrong, you're going to have errors throughout your worldview, and that's metaphysics. What types of things exist in the world? That is the question of metaphysics. I just want to say one thing.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So one concrete example of that is in political philosophy. If you get your metaphysics wrong and you think that governments are into separate entities from individuals, that there are these things that are out there separate from individuals, you're going to make errors throughout your political philosophy.
Yeah, okay, so when I was inhaling to ask the question, you just answered it. Basically, like, as you move back up the chain, right, from, let's say, political philosophy, past ethics and epistemology to metaphysics, if it's not right there, you don't have much of a prayer of being right at any other branch of philosophy.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes. And I mean, how pronounced, and your audience will understand this specifically about politics. How pronounced is it that error in not understanding the nature of government when you're talking to political philosophers or political scientists or average people in the public or talking heads on, you know, the news media? Nobody gets that. Everybody makes these foundational basic errors, not because they're stupid, but because they haven't examined them. And then entirely as a result of not examining these foundational things, they get something wrong. And then their entire worldview is based on this flawed metaphysical concept. And it becomes even more pronounced when you have a flawed epistemological concept. When somebody thinks, for example, one claim on how we arrive at knowledge about the world is faith, is blind faith. Now, I don't mean faith in terms of reasoned trust or other ways where you can salvage the concept of faith. I mean faith as it is preached in evangelical circles that I come from, which is belief without reason or belief in the absence of reason. This is a claim that we can have knowledge about something just by believing the conclusions and not asking why questions and not understanding the reasoning behind it. This is a flawed, demonstrably flawed methodology. I wrote a couple of pieces about this if anybody's interested on my site. Just type in faith and you'll see I can demonstrate very clearly why that is not an accurate epistemological method for arriving at true conclusions. That is a foundational, critical error that you just can't get wrong if you care about the truth.
Okay, so here's a related question. You spent 4 years studying political science.
Yes.
How much of a foundation in political philosophy is there? I'm completely ignorant. I have no idea. So it's not a leading question. I know you said you went to a liberal school where lots of, you know, there might not be certain types of unpacking that are allowed, but I honestly don't know the answer to that question. So how much of a foundation in political philosophy do you get in the attainment of a 4-year degree in political science?
It would be presumptuous of me to say that my experience is the experience of people at large. So I can't say for anything other than my own education and of the education of peers that I've spoken with who also have degrees in political science, but it's non-existent. I can think of literally one class that I took in my entirety of my 4 years in college where we were actually close to discussing these ideas about the fundamental nature of government. We were talking about John Locke and we were talking about the social contract. And we briefly touched on it, and then, you know, it was a few days in the curriculum, and then we went on. So almost all of political philosophy starts with a premise, the unchallenged, unexamined premise that, of course, governments are legitimate. We can't have anarchy. We can't have savagery. Having governments is synonymous with having civilization, and that's just the starting point from there.
Yeah, you know, an example that I used on the show a long time ago, Sam Harris. Are you somewhat familiar with his work?
Yes.
I really like. I mean, there's things with Sam Harris where I really disagree, but he is just amazing to listen to, and
yes,
I have a lot of respect. I have a lot of respect for him. He was talking about free will, right? Now he's kind of tied free will to being a concept of religious origin. So he's against it, and he is very much a determinist, and he doesn't want to talk about, you know, any kind of middle ground like compatibilism. He's very firm on this. And I'm listening to him talk about free will, and he's way over my head, right? Just in his knowledge, what he's talking about. But I'm like, he really seems like he's making an effort to define this out of existence. Like he's putting such a narrow definition on what free will is, that there's no way that you're silly if you think this is such a thing that exists. And he also appears to be quite the masterful logician, right? So this is an example of what we were talking about earlier. He's not making epistemological errors, right? He's making errors more in the question of what actually exists, not how do we know, right? So a lot of people can get logic right, but not a definition wrong. Right.
Yes, I can't say that I'm particularly familiar with his epistemology, but I do agree that he makes metaphysical errors. In fact, I think he is very heavy on competent rhetoric. I think he's wonderful to listen to. I enjoy listening to them, but I actually don't find his arguments that persuasive. Perhaps now that I think about it, because it's what you're bringing up, that he makes a metaphysical error just in the terms of how he comes up with his definitions. And you see that phenomenon all the time. The central example of this is the existence of God, which is a question that has been treated seriously for all of human history. And only relatively recently have people said, no, God cannot exist because God would involve a logical contradiction. It's like, well, if that's your definition of God, then yeah, almost everybody's going to agree with you. Of course that guy doesn't exist, but that's not what we're talking about. So it's just a simple, a really elementary definitional error that people think, oh, they've resolved all these issues in philosophy for the past several thousand years because they've defined something some certain way.
Yeah, you know, another example kind of counter to that is a lot of people that I talked to who went to, you know, Christian private schools, they talked about in their education a real focus on logic, the study of logic and rhetoric, but not so much on the actual grammar portion of the trivium. And Christians actually did basically adopt the trivium as a teaching tool starting probably over 1,000 years, maybe roughly 1,000 years ago. And the idea that I think is present in a lot of places, maybe even in your experience from what you're describing to studying political science, is here's a gift called knowledge, but don't open it, right?
Yeah,
don't look at what's actually inside. Just assume that what we've defined for you here can't be unpacked or examined any further, right?
Close. So two things. One, specifically in religion, I think you're pointing to something a little bit deeper, because there is this idea, very popular idea, not just in religion, but a very popular idea that some questions about the nature of reality by themselves cannot be resolved, so there's no point in examining them. There are questions about, they say, oh, well, those are God questions, so you can't ask those type of questions. Mm-hmm. But my experience in political science and in academia in general is not necessarily that claim, which is about the nature of reality. This is about the assumptions that you can't challenge because they're self-evidently obvious, that of course we need governments. Yes, you can examine them, but it's like you're a fool if you do so, because everybody agrees for these reasons. The same thing, I think I was talking a little bit about mathematics before, that nobody anymore examines the foundations of mathematics regarding the existence of infinite sets, for example. They say, well, of course this is the case. So it's not that, like, on the one hand, you say this is intrinsically unresolvable, and on the other hand, you say, well, this is what everybody agrees to, and you're a fool if you don't.
All right. Yeah, that makes sense. I understand that. I did have another question about logic, though. Tools for testing arguments, right? Because we see a lot showing up in the world. This is really a great season filled with examples of this. These fallacies, these things that on the surface are passable as representations of what actually exists, but it's like it's kind of like a magic trick, right? It's the little thing that you don't see or the little thing that you don't notice that makes something ridiculous yes. and not in concert with reality seem yes. realistic. So we're seeing a lot of that right now. When we talked about logic on the show in the past, we basically dealt with four components: deductive reasoning, inductive reasoning, the rules of definition, and basically an understanding of what the fallacies are. Mm-hmm. And I bring that up because I think that knowing maybe, I don't know, 15 to 20 types of logical fallacies creates a kind of alarm system. You know, yeah. I mean, especially when we're young and there's targets all over us for the people yes. who are trying to trick us, you know? But being able to set up some kind of alarm system, like, you know, I was much more, advanced in my understanding of the world when I looked at Sam Harris and said, okay, I think this guy is much smarter than me and more well read than I am on this subject, but something that he's doing is wrong. And yeah. I'm going to figure out what it is. Now, we grow up in a world, whether it's political or societal or religious, where we are basically inundated with appeals to authority, right? That is basically how the world is explained to us, from because I said so to because that's what God wants to because that's the law. It's everywhere. And so when we see the mainstream media or a collection of presidential candidates, if they seem to be in command and they seem to be speaking, you know, authoritatively about a subject, most people buy it, right?
Right.
So let's talk just a little bit about the fallacies as basically a tool for evaluating arguments.
Sure. So this would specifically be a concrete example of the basics mm-hmm. in epistemology. So this is examining the structure of argumentation, regardless of what the specifics of the argument is. So that this is one of, in fact, this is one of the profound things that you discover in studying philosophy, is that you can actually analyze the structure, pure structure of an argument, and regardless of the conclusions, regardless of the specifics, just in the abstract, and see whether or not that structure is something that is legitimate. And the unfortunate, or fortunate, I suppose, depending on your disposition, conclusion of understanding what makes a valid argument, what makes an invalid argument, is that you'll see invalid arguments all over the place, and it's very difficult to explain to somebody why that's the case, because you have to dive into these abstractions. You have to say, oh, no. Like, for example, a compelling way to demonstrate somebody's flawed argument is by analogy. You see, so somebody is saying, if X, then Y, if Y, then Z. You say, no, you're confused, because if A, then B, and B, then C. It's like, well, I don't know, what are you talking about? Two different things. What are you talking about? And what you try to do is give an analogy and say, no, if you follow your reasoning, you lead toward this silly conclusion, which is difficult if somebody is not comfortable and versed in the nature of abstractions. It's just a very difficult thing to do. And this is why also I think the field of philosophy and the field of analyzing fallacies as having a kind of basics in understanding of philosophy is analyzing fallacies is something that is not a particularly social discipline, because there's just not a lot of people that are willing to listen. And the other part of this is what you were talking about is rhetoric, is the power of rhetoric, because there's a difference between understanding the fallacies in an argument and being able to communicate the fallacies in the argument of an argument and being able to persuade somebody of the fallacies of an argument. Those are three very, very different areas. My interest is in the understanding. And sometimes that comes at the expense of the other ones. Other people, politicians, for example, their main focus is on the persuasion, is on the rhetoric, is on the niceness of the sounding of their words, even if their arguments are actually invalid.
Well, that's true because, I mean, like, let's take Donald Trump, for example. Mm-hmm. Donald Trump doesn't deal with facts or numbers. He deals in declarative statements only. And he will deliberately misdirect away from, give me an example, tell me the how much, quantify this thing. Yes. He won't do that because people don't think that way. They don't want to go there. So we're seeing like how successful that problem that you're talking about is if somebody can harness it for their benefit.
Yes. I mean, let's talk concretely, right? So yeah. I'm going to build a wall and I'm going to make Mexico pay for it.
Yeah.
Okay. Now you can analyze the structure of that and say, okay, well, let's take away the specifics. And we say, X is going to happen because I declare X is going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So it is going to rain because I'm going to make it rain.
Right.
Well, hang on. That is not, there has to be something else there. You can't simply actually be claiming that you're going to make Mexico pay for the wall because you declare it. So we can demonstrate there must be some other argument behind that in order for it to have any attempt at being reasonable. But people don't get that far. They say, oh, well, he said this is going to be the case, so that's going to be the case. It's like, that's not how the world works.
Yeah. Maybe you have some maybe you have some experience with this technique as well. It's usually the thing that I do in an argument before the other person calls me an asshole. And it goes a little bit like this. I take the logic that they're applying to, say, a political situation, and I just take whatever the kind of syllogism is that they're using, and I don't have an example at the top of my head right now. I pull it out of the political context and drop it somewhere else and show them what it looks like in another situation. And it exposes how many things people just take as a given and how many things they're unwilling to examine, right? When you say, okay, well, you agree that this is the logical flow that you're using. These are the syllogistic relationships that you're using. So we're going to lift them up and move them into this situation regarding, you know, selling bananas and try again, replicating the same logic that you just agreed on, and look what happens. Look how silly. You know?
Yes. The example that comes to mind is something like the conservative argument against drug use, or I should say specifically arguments for the government's war on drugs.
Okay.
Because their argument is, oh, well, it's bad for you. Oh, well, it's bad for families. And our argument, if I may be so presumptuous as to think I understand your argument without hearing it, is that as long as it's peaceful and it's not affecting somebody, it should be legal. If I want to smoke pot in my basement, it doesn't affect anybody. There should not be a law against that.
Right.
Now, what you're saying is taking this argument and putting it somewhere else. If we apply their reasoning, as I've done many times with not much success, we would, of course, arrive at the same conclusions about tobacco and about alcohol, and about eating too many hamburgers. Is the principle that one is appealing to that it should be illegal to do things that harm you? Because if that's the principle, we can demonstrate that that's a very dumb principle, and it doesn't make a lot of sense that you would lock people up for smoking a cigarette, or you would lock people up for having a dessert that was too sweet. And then they'll say, oh, okay, well, that's not the actual principle. It's that smoking marijuana, for example, hurts the families. Because it hurts yourself, it hurts the families because you become a deadbeat father or something like that. It's like, well, hang on. Is the principle then that it should be illegal to do things which are irresponsible for your family? If that's the principle, then again, the same thing applies with eating unhealthy. How many people have heart problems because they eat unhealthy? You have to be consistent. If this is the structure of your argument, you can't do this because of that, then you take it out of the specifics, you apply it here, and you can demonstrate that that's just not a good argument.
Absolutely. And you can go to the other side of the two-dimensional political spectrum and do the same routine with something like gun control.
Yes.
You know, certainly. And lift it out and move it into, highway safety.
Right.
And
knife control, which there is now in Britain. It used to be an absurdity. People used to say in the United States, you want to ban guns. What, do you want to ban knives? Because knives can be used to stab people. Well, actually, there's a movement in Britain, people saying, oh, well, you probably don't actually need such sharp knives because they can hurt people. What used to be an absurdity is now becoming a reality in Britain.
Oh, good heavens. Well, what are they going to do? Like, people don't realize dull knives are dangerous.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, sure.
People think they're safe cutting a tomato with a dull knife, but that's how people will, you'll lose a thumb that way. So we'll see how they deal with that epidemic when it springs up with all their dull knives.
And this is a great example, though, of going back to the basics, mm-hmm. because people deal with periphery arguments all the time. They're stuck on the periphery, the specifics of banning guns in this particular city or not. Like, that usually is a waste of time, not just because it's not persuasive, but because people are unaware of these foundational basic premises that they presuppose and don't examine. And the most effective conversations I've had by far are not when you're dealing with periphery cases, but when you're dealing with the core ideas. Like, let's not talk about gun control unless we talk about what is the government? What is the nature of laws and how are they enforced? You know, that is a much more streamlined way to talk to somebody and get them to see your way of thinking rather than just beating around on the very edges of one's worldview. And another great example of this is bringing all this back full circle is examining the basic principles of what you're doing right now, which is podcasting. So from your own experience on the top of your head, I don't know, it's fine if you haven't thought about it. Are there basic core things, the fundamental techniques that you have to get correct and right 80 to 90% of the time? That's the majority of podcasting. And if you focus on the rest, it's kind of periphery.
Yeah, there are. I mean, to even start thinking about how to answer the question, there has to be some category assignments of really specific things. And the fastest way that I can think of doing it, like just on the fly here, would be pre-production, production, and post-production. So every phase has its own set of fundamentals. You know, and I would even say that there is more of a foundation, that all those aspects of production sit on, like a basic knowledge of the equipment that you're using. Now, the troubling thing is that in that foundation, there are so many individual what's that I haven't even discovered them all yet. Right. So I had a problem recently, just as an example, some kind of electronic hiss in the recording that shouldn't be there. There's no excuse for it. And I mean, I have equipment that's supposed to like clean the power. I live in a city and I live in a densely populated area. So there's lots of electricity being used right around me, but I can't figure out what's causing this problem. But this is one of the fundamentals of, the foundational things is how do you get electronic noise out of your signal chain,
exactly.
Right? So something I haven't mastered yet. I can have a $300 microphone, but that's not going to solve the problem if it exists somewhere in like the actual power supply.
And you could have not only just an expensive microphone, you could have a great podcast. You could be interviewing all these fancy people, and if you've got an obnoxious hiss, you're not doing it right.
Absolutely. Oh, when I started this show, the sound quality was so awful. Because I started in 2009 and I said to myself one day that summer, wow, I can record my voice and make it appear on the internet. I'm starting a podcast. And I did, right?
Nice.
And people thought it was good enough that they were willing to invest in it. My first microphone upgrade actually came from, Stefan Molyneux sent me, after he interviewed me, he sent me the microphone that he used to use for his car casts,
nice.
this little Sony, and it improved the sound quality dramatically. But everyone would write to me, yeah, Brett, your show's great. Sound quality sucks. You should do something about that. So all I had at the beginning was ideas, like this backlog, this bottleneck of ideas from, you know, 10 years of experience, 10 years of frustration working in and around these schools, that as soon as I had a way to get my voice on the internet, I just exploded out with like 50 episodes, during which time the sound quality improved gradually. But I didn't care about what the fundamentals were. I was just so eager. There was just so much momentum mm-hmm. at the beginning that once I knew a crappy way of doing what I wanted to do, I was doing it. Mm-hmm. And the advice I would give now to people is do things entirely different than that. So
yes, and that brings up another good point which we touched on earlier, but I really want to restate, and it's that, and we'll certainly talk a lot more about this in the last principle, but it's this principle of humility, that were it the case that I said, oh hey Brett, the problem that you're having with your sound is something very simple. It's like, oh, you got to press a button on your computer. You got to press the button on the microphone. And like, you've been forgetting to do this the whole time. In order to be competent and really master what you're doing, you have to be open to that. Like, it could be the case that all along you've been doing the basics wrong in perhaps some elementary way. And you have to have, I'm not coming down on you or anything. I'm saying in the abstract, everybody has to have the openness to realize that some foundational thing that they were doing, some foundational idea that they had in their worldview might be fundamentally wrong. A great example of this is I'm trying to learn how to draw. Forever, I've been a terrible, embarrassingly, terribly bad drawer. I just suck. Although I love looking at pencil drawings. I think they're awesome. I've never been able to do it. My sister-in-law is a art teacher. She teaches art at a middle school. And so recently, this Thanksgiving, we were sitting around the table. I was like, hey, can you teach me kind of the basics of drawing, because I really want to learn. And the first thing I tried to draw, like, everybody was laughing at because it was so bad. I was like, that's cool. Yeah, I know I'm bad. I suck at it. That's fine. I want to learn. And I was asking questions like how embarrassing this could be if I was trying to prove something. I said, how do you hold a pencil? Right? Serious question. I don't know. I never learned how to hold a pencil. How do you hold a pencil when you're trying to draw? I don't know. But then I learned. And the answer is it depends on the how heavy you want the line to be. I had no idea. And I should find some of the drawings I've been working on in a very short period of time. I got pretty damn good. That's not because I'm really smart or anything. It's just I had no idea of the basics. And had I thought, oh, I know how to hold a pencil.
Yeah, absolutely. That's interesting. And, you know, I would say back to my experience too, there are a lot of those like holding the pencil type things that go beyond just producing, right? That are about this whole project as basically a job, as a money making endeavor that is supposed to grow and reach more people and have a grander effect over time. So I look at other people. I don't know how this is going to sound, but I'm going to say it. Who do like, you know, liberty themed podcasts. They're libertarians and they have similar ideas to present and they might use a similar format in a lot of ways. And there might even be a lot of overlap in audience, but they are doing a product or putting out a product that I think as far as its quality is inferior to, but they're more successful. Right? Because they know all these little other things that I haven't tapped into yet. So right. I listen to their show and I say, ah, that show's about education and you're using another brick in the wall as the bumper music. Like that's so cliche. Like that's so predictable. You couldn't think of anything. I wouldn't do that. You know, I did do it once, but it's not the theme song for the show. And there was a reason why I used it. So I would have those little judgments, but then I would see like, you know, going to their website or seeing their audience engagement or getting an email from them. And I would say, wow, there are a lot of fundamentals that this person understands that I don't. You know, I just kind of like ran away with what was happening and here I am. And obviously I've tried to add as much knowledge as I can, helpful knowledge as I go. But there are always fundamentals, I think, and maybe this is true across the board in any discipline, where improvement can be made and attention can go, I would think.
Yeah, it's an excellent example. And here's the analogy. It would be like somebody who has a masterful forehand. They have a great serve, but they don't have a backhand. And there's this other shot that they see other people doing. It's like, how are you doing that? There's this thing and the ball's on the other side of of my body, and I just don't have that. And naturally, if you don't have that piece of the puzzle, where your game could be is nowhere near where it is because you're missing one piece of the puzzle. I'm certainly in the same boat in terms of producing content and getting it out there and getting a bigger audience. I'm in the exact same boat.
Right. Absolutely. So as we come to the end today, and we've been using this last little segment here for takeaways, let me put the question to you like this. If somebody wants to learn tennis, or if somebody wants to learn how to play the drums, let's say, what would your advice be to them starting at basically zero knowledge and competence? What should they do first?
Number one, be aware that you're starting at zero. Absolutely essential. Don't focus on trying to execute. You have to focus on the basics, which means you need to go to YouTube, find somebody who has demonstrated competence in terms of executing their technique efficiently and in a relaxed way, like we talked about last time, and see and try to find the people that explain the very basics of how to hold a drumstick, how to hit the drum, you know, where to hit the drum, right? If you're hitting the drums on the wrong part of the head, you're not going to get a good sound. So you have to deliberately, consciously seek out those fundamentals and then practice those slowly. That's the key. And now it may be, if you're, what might even accelerate your progress even more is to try to find a trainer in person, try to find an instructor whom you respect, who has demonstrated an understanding of the basics and has demonstrated their competence, and try to get them to coach you specifically about the basics. You have to be a little careful though, because I found coaches a lot of times want to get the student to execute, and they don't spend the time focusing on the basics. So it's very, your likelihood of finding a instructor who's going to really hone in on the basics is probably rather slim. So if you're self-direct and you go to YouTube or Google or find these books about the very basics, you're probably going to have better luck focusing on the fundamentals than not.